Does this draw these on?
Yes, we can. Please, go ahead, Mr. Thompson.
Thank you. I prepared a comment on the study that we're discussing that was submitted early August, and I don't propose to go over that in detail because it stands for itself, but I'll touch on a number of points briefly. In summary, I concluded that the draft study was both misleading and incomplete, and I'm sad to hear that the NRC staff continues to make misleading statements, which they did in the opening presentations for this meeting today. I wish the staff would stop pretending that they have examined a low-density fuel storage case in the pool. They have not, and they should be forthright and honest about what they have and have not done. Now, another point I make in my commentary is that the staff has constructed a superstructure of analysis, including regulatory analysis, based upon a very weak foundation of basic understanding of the phenomena of a pool fire. The potential for a pool fire has been known since at least 1979, so the NRC has had a period of 34 years during which it could have established a thorough understanding of the phenomena of a pool fire. It has not done so, despite many calls for this from public interest groups, state and local governments. It's essential to establish a solid science-based understanding before considering the event sequences that could cause water loss or presence of debris. Only by acquiring a really thorough understanding of the events that could lead to pool fire can one establish the intellectual base to be certain that you can then look at events that might lead to that outcome. Now, early on, people thought about pool fire and said, gee, the decay heat is very low, how can this be a problem? But as soon as you look at this problem, you realize that the nature of a high-density closed-form rack is such that heat transfer is very feeble, especially when there's flow blockage from residual water or debris. And therefore, you need a very careful analysis backed up by experiment to determine whether your hottest or highest decay heat fuel can reach the ignition point. You need further very careful analysis to see how that fire propagates within the first affected assembly and to other assemblies. This work has simply never been done properly. In this instance, the staff has taken the Melchior code, which was written for other purposes, and has adapted it without providing our explanation of how they've done this adaptation or what experimental validation they have for it. The staff has admitted in its own report that the Melchior code uses a very crude process of modeling radiative heat transfer, which we know is a crucial phenomenon in determining the heat up of fuel, particularly in the event of flow blockage. The staff also concedes that Melchior has no capability to examine clad ballooning or rupture, phenomena which can affect fuel heat up and ignition. So my recommendation is that this study be scrapped completely and that the NRC go back to basics, start with a clean slate, and develop a really solid understanding of the phenomena of plumping a pool fire. I've laid out in my comments of August 1st briefly how that could be done. And in doing so, the staff would need to address, among other issues, those raised by the ACRS in a letter to the NRC chair of April 13th, 2000. And a number of significant phenomena were identified in that letter report pertaining to the phenomena of pool fires. I'll touch on them briefly. Firstly, with high burnout fuel, secondly, the presence of zirconium hydrides that could lead to spontaneous combustion of ignition in air. Spontaneous combustion of zirconium cladding in air, excuse me. Secondly, zirconium air reaction can occur even if oxygen is depleted via exothermic zirconium nitrogen reactions. And associated particularly with the hydride issue is the point that ignition temperature may be an inappropriate criterion, and in fact energy balance may be more appropriate criterion for determining whether a fire initiates. The letter also stated that the staff had neglected exothermic reactions of aluminum and stainless steel. In the event that fire initiated, they said that the staff had neglected the potential release of small particles arising from decrepitation of fuel. And they further stated that the max code was prone to using an excessively narrow plume and therefore could underestimate land contamination. So these issues have not been addressed in the current study that I can see. Perhaps the staff will explain to me how they've been addressed. But if this problem were looked at in a really systematic science-based manner, the scientific community more broadly could examine all of these issues, and if done correctly, we'd have a really solid understanding of the underlying phenomena. And then and only then we reach regulatory conclusions. And in the interim, I think it's prudent to take a conservative position that these findings would lead to the identification of a substantial range of circumstances wherein a pool fire could occur. And just some closing points about the responsibilities of NRC in this matter. The NRC is the world's biggest regulator, and therefore is looked to by regulators in other nations, and I believe has a global responsibility to establish a thorough understanding of the pool fire issue. And in illustration of the significance of this, I personally viewed a 6 PWR unit station in Asia where the spent fuel pools are all above grade. I'm also aware of a large nuclear facility in a European country that is licensed to hold in excess of 17,000 tons of spent PWR fuel in 4 high-density spent fuel pools, configured so that the grade level is approximately mid-high of the fuel. And undoubtedly other situations like this can be identified around the world. So I emphasize that NRC has a global responsibility to really come to grips with the kilometer of a pool fire. And finally, on the security issue, the United States government reserves the right to conduct aerial strikes on countries around the world and has done so frequently. The NRC has chosen not to require air defense of U.S. nuclear power plants. If you put those actions together, I believe it's the NRC's duty to accurately inform the United States public of the phenomena associated with a spent fuel pool fire. Thank you. That's my commentary.